Hello everyone, I'm at the Thoronka Law Office and I have with me Ishmael Thoronka and Ms. Kamah Thoronka. And there's a saying that when America sneezes, everybody catches a cold. And in the absence of information, there is speculation. President Trump has recently signed an immigration order. And the fallout of it is we hear a lot of information about immigration rates in the community. People are uncertain. People overseas are worried. We just need answers. So today, I'm here to talk to the Thoronka law officers. Yes, there's this issue circulating on social media that if you're not a U.S. citizen, you have to carry your I-94 or your green card with you everywhere you go, just in case. And this is coming out of the fallout of the immigration order. Is it a law that we need to know about? Has it always been there or something new? And what do we need to carry with us?
It's not a law.
Okay.
Just like when you want to have identifications on you for any other purpose.
Yes.
If you have your green card, you should carry it for identification for your job. But it's not a law because of the executive order. And as a point of correction, there's portions of the ban that was struck down by the courts. And I'm sure that President Trump administration is going to file with the Supreme Court on the travel ban. It was signed as an executive order. The appeals court struck that down, and there were talks that it would be filed with the Supreme Court. But notwithstanding, I think the concern is, because there is a sweeping executive order, the discretion has not been defined behind that order. So people are having problems at the border, especially at the airport, so that when people are coming, the custom enforcement officers do not have guidelines as to how and who they should really check. So that sweeping discretion a bit hammering for a lot of people that are coming in. So the fear is there. They might detain you. They might question you deeper, even though you're not from one of the seven countries that the ban was really set out to affect. So overall, I know the fear is there for a lot of people. And but the ban was supposed to be specifically for certain countries. But I think the lack of guidelines on some of what is being said is causing that panic when it first came out.
Can you add your take on that?
You always want to carry your identification.
Yes, like a driver's license.
Right, driver's license and ID. Sometimes yes. People cannot drive, but you have a yes. state ID. And just if a police officer was to stop you, and you know, they ask you for your driver's license, your ID if you're a passenger in a car, you give those information and they ask you what is your name, and you say your name, and you don't really need to say anything else beyond yes. that. You know, a few people, they call us continuously, and sometimes people take even incidents that happen overseas
yes.
and they tend to attribute them here, you know, okay. in the United States.
Yes.
It's not really the way to go. People should not have fear, because once you're inside the United States, whether you're a foreigner or you're a citizen of the United States, the Constitution, the laws protects you. When, you know, Attorney Thoronka was talking about the ban, was the state portion of it. The ban itself has not been decided by the courts.
Okay.
Well, They have almost like, they call it almost in law, it's an injunctive relief, an
okay.
injunction, you know, stay.
Yeah.
Said, you know, the president said, you know, January 27,
mm-hmm.
these people cannot come. And the entire, you know, country became, you know, the airport was chaos.
Mm-hmm.
And I happened to be away at that time. So I had to, you know, all get emails to go to the airport to help people that are coming in. So we were there to help. But, you know, the president has the right, you know, to suspend immigrants, really.
Yes.
And immigration law, the regulations allow him to do that for 90
okay.
days. So
it's just a temporary situation.
It's a temporary situation. It's not anything
okay.
Anything permanent.
So, from the day he signed the executive order to the time he revised it, when did the clock start ticking?
Well, the old order, the clock was still running, but now he issued a new order. At that time.
Yes.
So that's a new order. And they're about to issue another new order again. Okay. Because all those other orders are, you know, being tied up in courts anyway, in litigation. So they cannot really execute them.
Right. Okay. Nothing is really being executed.
So currently, we should say it's suspended. So anybody from those countries can enter at this moment.
At this moment, yes. They can come in if they have a visa or they have a green card to come into the United States. Mm-hmm. But one thing you and I, or anybody else, really realize, as foreigners, or even as American citizens, you know, when we're coming in at the border, your rights are so limited. You don't really have any rights, either at the airport or if you're crossing the border to enter the United States. So even before the ban, when you come in, they call it a vetting system.
Yes.
When you're coming in, you always have to go through inspection.
Yes.
Right? Right. And sometimes they might put you, call you for secondary inspection because they need to ask you more questions.
Yes.
You know,
but the problem is, with the band, I think people are getting a bit wary because with the band, because it came to a sort of forefront.
Yes.
And I think the general problem is when the policy is issued, they're not constructing a process for those guys at the border.
Okay.
Because like Attorney Thoronka was saying, at the border, the rights are very limited. So if you're coming in with a green card, for example, and they go through the regular inspection process, and they see that maybe you committed a crime, of a theft crime back in 2005.
Yes.
Besides the ban, they have a right, at that point, they can pull you aside and tell you, look, you are in a situation, you were convicted of this crime, and we have a conviction, and you were issued a 1 year plus sentence, so that makes you an aggravated felony. So we may parole you in, but we're not going to give you admission.
Yes.
And then you have to come back, you have to bring your documents from the court to show that you have been everything was clear, or maybe you took care of that issue, or maybe the issue was not that serious, and then they might decide to admit you into the country. So those things are happening already. But I think the major problem is when you give a blanket policy, a ban, and there are no process for the people who are issuing it at the border.
Yes.
Besides the seven countries that they, the predominantly Muslim countries that he had on the list, other people were being stopped because everybody was sort of lumped up. For example, my husband's name is Ishmael.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he's not from one of those Muslim countries, but he has a name that is associated with Muslim.
Right.
So he may have gotten red flagged and put to sit for hours and beyond the regulated time to get, vetted even more thoroughly. So I think the chaos is coming from people with green cards who are being stopped and things like that. So the people who are concerned about this, like Ayla and other people said, look, people with green cards should not be stopped, even if they are from the Muslim banned country. They should go through your regular vetting process. They shouldn't be denied entry. And that was another issue. Some of them were being denied entries because people at the border were not given any kind of guidelines on what to do. So their discretion was just so wide. They can do whatever they want. And I think that's the major issue. But to go back to your point about what should I carry and should I lock my doors, I think generally across the board, as Attorney Thoronka said, when you reside in the United States, you have some rights under the Constitution.
Okay.
So you can enforce those rights. If a police officer shows up, do they have a warrant for your arrest? Do they have, what kind of information do you give them? And things like, they have a right to counsel. You have a right, there are certain rights, of course, you can't vote, but those things, you got to just be careful.
Let me say, so if you're driving and you have just your driver's license, that is enough. You don't have to carry your green card with you. So long as you have a state-issued ID, you don't necessarily have to have your green card with you.
That's not mandated law that you have
to. It's not mandated.
But, I mean, because you use your green card for jobs, if you want to apply for things, loans, maybe banks. So they don't mandate you as they do as a driver's license. If you get behind that wheel, you must carry a driver's license, and that's a law.
So if a police officer asks you that, then it's discretionary. He's using his own discretion to probe further.
Of course.
Okay.
And that's
they
the
don't
problem.
Have to. Yes.
No, I mean, they necessarily don't have to. But again, that is where I talk about the kind of wide discretion, where in a local police officer that really don't have the authority, the independent authority to really probe into your immigration matter, but they will. And if and once it's started and you open up that can of worm, then you can't stop it. If they realize you don't have papers, then
generally we're hearing stories about immigration raids in certain quarters. Like you said, on social media, we're seeing certain videos that are being attributed to the United States. Are we really, that are these immigration raids really real in the United States right now?
Some of them they are. The deportation policy for President Trump is actually to get rid of the criminals.
Criminals, okay.
Right. And so sometimes what had happened is they've deported people,
yes.
And people have gone and crossing the border 3, 4, 5, 6 times. They don't care. You send them today, and they'll come back tomorrow. You know, been doing this for a long time. So sometimes, you know, at least one, you know, in a one time in our practice, you run into that wherein you're representing a client, they're sitting in jail, they get tired.
Yes.
And they will say, don't worry, I'm going to, you know, just let me go. I'll go. Okay. I'll come back, you know. So you have those, you know, people that have been in and out, you know, of the United States. So they're looking for them, and some of them, they've committed some bad crimes.
Yes.
They're not supposed to be here. But because the United States is big enough, so people can move around.
Okay.
So those are the people they're looking for.
What we want people to know is that the focus, first of all, is on those who have committed serious crimes. Yes. How about those who are undocumented?
Well, the undocumented ones, the policy has always been there.
Yes.
And mind you, though, I mean, I understand because President Trump here is raising eyebrows. But Obama did the same thing.
Yes.
Obama's administration did the same thing and even deported more people.
Yes.
So whenever you illegal in this country, you're violating the laws of the United States. So you always run at a risk of either you being apprehended, you know, or being questioned by an immigration officer. But you know what? People sometimes, you know, the mistake that they do, they said ICE, you know,
yes.
They, you know, immigration enforcement,
yes.
Custom enforcement. So they will come, they call them ICE because it's cold,
yes.
You know,
yes.
When they come in.
Immigration,
right.
Customs Enforcement,
right.
That is ICE, ICE,
right.
Okay.
So what had happened is they will come and maybe some of them will even come up with, you know, different names.
Yes.
And they said they're looking for somebody.
Okay.
And they knock at your door. And most often, people will just get up and open the door, because once they see that badge or they say I'm an officer or things. So foreigners forget really their rights.
Okay.
You do not have to open the door for that officer. Even when they show warrants, it depends what is the warrant for, because usually, typically, immigration officers will come with a warrant of arrest of somebody.
Okay.
They don't come in with a warrant to come search your home.
Okay.
That's why they ask you if it's okay for them to come in. When you let them in, you give them the scope for them to, you know, scoop around.
Yes.
To, yeah. They can ask you for identification. You can identify, this is my name. This is, you know, they might ask you for ID. This is my ID. You know, pretty much that's it. You don't have to allow them to come in. You know, actually, by law, if they really want to come into your house, and usually they'll have all the search warrant, they have to come with a local police officer anyway.
Yes.
You know, so that's usually what it is. But, you know, when they knock at your door, say, I have a lawyer. This is my lawyer's number. Call my lawyer.
So you want to say ICE does not have arresting powers unless they have local enforcement with them?
No, they do have arresting powers. ICE, because they come in, they have a warrant of arrest.
Yes.
Maybe I've been deported.
Yes.
I have a green card, but I've committed a crime.
Yes.
That makes me, you know, based on immigration law, they say you're inadmissible.
Yes.
And then you're deportable or you're removable. Now they, instead of
you're
deportation,
removable. Yes,
now they call it removal. So What would happen in that case is they have a warrant of arrest for Ishmael Thoronka. Mm-hmm. Now, if they come in here and they say, who is Ishmael? They said, this is Ishmael Thoronka. I'm outside. Mm-hmm. They can come and arrest me, but they cannot come in, you know, in my house.
Yes.
Unless somebody invite them in to come arrest me. Mm-hmm. That's the point I was trying to make.
So you don't have to open your door.
You don't,
so,
you know.
You speak to your lawyer or yes. you call your lawyer.
You can crack the door a little bit, you know.
Yes, you can crack the door.
Americans that yes. know their rights, yes. even when the police come there,
yes.
they will crack the door a little bit. I need to see the warrant, they read it, right? Before they let you in, right?
Yes.
All right. Now, they can only come in and push that door and enter. That's what we, you know, in America, you know, we have the laws to protect us.
We've had situations where they've broken into people's homes. You just open it slightly, and then they just break the door to come in.
Well, yeah, I mean, they push the door. They'll push it aside. I mean, I've had situations where they're in and they're looking in underwear drawers. They're looking everywhere and stuff. If you, for example, you are standing there and ICE showed up, or the immigration officers, or just regular immigration officers, and they are invading your space in that manner, and they don't have a warrant to do so, you can call the police and report, because technically you now it's trespassing. If I'm an officer and I'm opening your drawers and looking for things that I don't have a warrant to a search, I can call and file a complaint because you don't have a warrant to search. And here you are looking around my apartment or opening my drawers and stuff.
But even if they do have a warrant, do they have the right to break your door and come in and then search?
Well, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, that's the problem. It's almost like splitting hairs. They don't have a right to destroy your property. Yes. Unless there is a crime being committed and they feel there is danger or something like that. But usually, in they say in criminal law, when they are there and then they see something that's suspicious, of course, now they have to operate under the scope of their job, which is to protect at that point. If they saw something that's out in the open. But when an ICE officer come in, they're generally, or immigration officers, they're generally coming because either they have information already, but it's a fishing expedition also. Most of the time, we give them the rest of the information they need, and that's when they go ahead and do what they have to do. Breaking the door down or pushing the door down, yeah, I mean, there's no law said that it's legal or illegal. I think, you know, you got to kind of find yourself in that situation to know. And once that happens and the warrant is not for you, or once they're in there and they start evading your space, you have a right now to report that, because that's not the proper procedure.
Is this something new, or it was just there, just that people were not aware until
President... It's always been there. I mean, as Attorney Thoronka pointed out, if you are here illegally or overstay, I mean, you are subject to removal, period. Yes. You just are.
And if you have committed a crime, you are still subject to removal.
It's just that some states... Now, if you can remember back 8 years ago, Virginia was very, very high on whether local police officers, even if you're walking, they could ask you for your papers.
Okay.
I mean, that's just plainly called profiling. I mean, black people are profiled in this country. That's the reality. So if you're Hispanic or maybe have an accent and you're profiled, and then they ask you and you start giving information, you're on the hook. So I think at this point, I'm also concerned about people who had a removal order. Yes. Before, even if they didn't commit a crime, but they had a removal order before a deportation, when they're rounding up people, you are also being rolled up. Yes. You know, when the hay is going,
and they have the database of all the people, so you stand a chance of being caught and removed.
But you know, they once they put an eye on it, as they have, then it's going to happen more at a rapid rate in some places.
Okay. Yes, and I would like to summarize something here to set people's minds at ease, especially green card holders who want to travel outside the country. People are kind of nervous. They might not allow me back or something. But we just want to clarify something here, that it's a standard procedure that when you travel outside the country and you're coming back, so long as you are a green card holder, you'll be subject to inspection. And it goes further if you have been fingerprinted for an offense, a crime before, they can pull you over for secondary inspection to go bring some documents or the back. If nothing like that, it's on your record. You don't have a reason to fear, or do you?
First of all, as a green card holder, or any person, like I said earlier on, when you're coming through the airport, you're subject to go through customs.
Yes.
But as a green card holder, immigration, mm-hmm. you know, and the custom
office and border protection, yes.
Right. The custom officers there, we'll call them CBP, mm-hmm. they will not stop you from entering the United States.
Okay.
And they not really allow, they cannot take your green card away from you.
Okay.
They might hold it if yes. they have some questions for yes. you to come back or get an attorney to help you, but they cannot.
Okay.
They have to parole you in unless, like you were saying, you okay. have committed so much crime, they can arrest you there, you know, detain you and allow you to get a day mm-hmm. before a judge.
Okay, so parole in, that means they will let you in, yeah. they will ask you to come. So they won't stop you.
They haven't admitted you, yes. right.
Yeah, they cannot say, okay, you're a green card holder, we're stopping you at the airport, we're sending you back on the next plane.
No.
Okay, great. Okay. We want to clarify
that. First of all, when you're a green card holder,
yes.
when you're coming in, you're not seeking admission.
Okay.
Right.
You're returning. Okay, great.
The only time you're seeking admission, like I said, like, you know, they find you at the airport, you're inadmissible because mm-hmm. of a serious crime that you've committed. Yes. Mm-hmm. So you're not going through all that okay. process. You know, you have to come back to your place.
Regardless, they will let you in.
Yes.
And then they'll put you before a judge if they
right.
have any issues.
Right. Immigration okay. has struggled with this, with whether or not somebody is seeking admission with a green card and then they classifying them okay. as arriving aliens. I mean, those are just deeper into more immigration practice before the immigration judges, but like he rightfully says, you're returning back.
Yes.
But again, my biggest problem really, it goes back to how these boys or girls as CBP is handling the situation. Yes. I mean, they would classify someone with a green card coming in as what they call arriving aliens,
yes. mm-hmm.
seeking admission at the border that already have a
shouldn't.
Well. In some cases, mm-hmm. I mean, when you kind of get kind of really deep in the law, it could potentially be. I mean, okay. without having to kind of get into the science of this the immigration law, but you will not just be turned back.
Okay.
You have to go through a process of removal. So they will okay. let you in, and then you have to go before the immigration judge. And then if you do that, that green card, I kind of give the example, like, it's now on the fence.
Okay.
The judge the judge can take that away if you lose your case or whatever you're going to be filing, because now you got to refile something before the judge to keep the green card.
And that's for people that have criminal records that they deem inadmissible.
Right,
if
correct.
You just have a green card,
oh, yeah, right,
you know,
exactly.
You have no fear of trial.
Right, right, right. There's no fear.
And
you don't
even
have any criminal record.
If you've been through proceedings before and the case is settled, your case is over,
that's
you still
it.
Don't have
You don't
no
have
problem.
Issues. Exactly.
No,
only
no
those
issue.
People with criminal records
yes.
that will face an immigration
yes.
judge. For the sake of them just trying to taunt you, they might
yes.
just want to, you know,
yes.
interview you more and more and
right.
more, make for fear. But that's what
just a secondary process, but definitely you will get in. So people
you will get in, because when we're talking about this, is like for state court.
Yes.
You know,
but it doesn't eradicate the crime.
No, it doesn't.
So if something else happened, they can go back to that same crime
correct.
Again and re-NTA you.
They can do that,
right.
But once, you know, you haven't committed any other offense, mm-hmm. then
Case is closed. Yes.
The case is closed.
Yes.
You know.
And it shows up in their system.
It shows up in the system.
They just want to verify.
Yeah. Yes. And sometimes they might call you for secondary inspection.
Okay.
I used to travel.
Because the conviction is still there.
Yeah, the conviction is still there.
I travel a lot. So sometimes they call me for secondary inspection.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
You know, until they know that I'm a lawyer, then they said, okay. Now all of a sudden they
As soon as you enter, mm-hmm. they have to do biometric fingerprinting on you. So everything on you will come up anyway.
Correct.
So in order to clear that, to make sure your case was closed, they will pull you over for a second. And if your case is closed, then you are admissible.
But I mean, at the end of the day, some countries like Ghana have dual citizenship. I tell
yes.
my clients, file for your citizenship. I mean,
yes.
unless you want to run for parliament
yes.
in your country, you file for citizenship, and then it alleviates all of the stress of
yes.
you coming back into the country, because
right.
now you're a citizen. I mean, again,
every opportunity you get, you file for your citizenship.
Yes,
you
of course, you got
to
file for that citizenship. So,
okay. So people are nervous about traveling at night, going to public places. Do they have a right to make a raid in a church or a public meeting?
Usually the churches know. They don't raid. Not that they don't. If they want to, they could enter there if they know something is going on.
No law bars them from leaving the church.
Right.
But normally they don't.
Yeah, but normally they will not do that.
Okay.
They no government official will walk into a worship place and start arresting people. I don't know if you're watching the news.
Yes.
There is a lady right now that is in a church.
Yes.
You know, that they want to deport. Yeah, you know, they're not going there.
He's taking refuge in a
right.
church.
So, you know, typically, no. They will not do that. Unless, like, you know, the exception is maybe this person is really dangerous. You know, it's wanted. You know, and probably they will do that. They will not go into a gathering and say, we're coming to, you know, raid and arrest all these people. If immigration wants to find you, they know how to find you.
Yes.
You know, I mean, this country cannot hide. They're not going to, you know, you can drive. You know, and if people want, they can always, you know, call us and, you know, talk to us and we'll be able to give them, you know, the right advice. And we'll look, you know, because with immigration, it's a case-by-case basis. What works for me will not work for, you know, him and will not work for her. So that's what we have to do.
But if you are facing removal proceedings, do not put a blind eye to it, because if you don't show up to court, you will be deported in your absence, and that makes your problem even worse. So even if you get married to someone now, you have a child, and now you're ready, you say, oh, I'm fine. That old removal order, it's still going to come back and haunt you. You still have to face that. That's something you're going to have to face. So please, if you have a removal order, notice to come to court, go to court, get a lawyer, call us, we'll represent you there so that you can fix that problem before you have more problems.
Yeah. Okay. Coming back to immigration, under what conditions can one's citizenship be revoked?
Wow. Basically, it's very, very difficult for your citizenship to be revoked once you've gotten citizen, you know, you become a citizen of the United States. We've had cases because for citizenship to be revoked, if you are dual citizenship or if you betray, you know, the United States, or you decide to take arms upon the United States, they can revoke your citizenship. So those are it's not too many things that you can do for a citizenship to be revoked once you've been, you know, sworn in as a citizen.
Because I guess on the citizenship application, there are allegiance.
Okay.
You know, allegiance to the flag, allegiance to bear arms, allegiance to whatever. So, as you say, if you violate any of that allegiance to the oath that you took, then, of course.
Immigration, do you also handle any areas like civil, criminal cases?
Oh, yes. We do have other attorneys here at Thoronka Law Offices. Actually, anything really that you think about, we do it. You know, criminal, you know, accident cases. We don't like people being divorced, but divorce cases, people that fight for children, you know, custody, visitation, child support, we do all those things. For people that want to do probate, or, you know, people that own businesses, you want to have your in-house counsel, we do that to write contracts for you. So we do a variety of things. So we're actually, even though we're known for immigration, but we're general, you know, practitioners, general practice, you know, law office.
We know Thoronka Law Office has been here for a long time, and they've been helping a lot of immigrants in the Washington metro area. So if anybody needs counseling on such issues, or they want to come see you, what number should they call?
Well, we have several locations. In our Virginia office, which is located in Woodbridge, 13198 Center Point Way in Woodbridge, Virginia, and we are going to be relocating down in Lake Ridge. I don't know that address off the top, but we're still setting that up. But you may call area code 571-285-5242 and just follow the prompt, so you could just hit extension 100. You'll be sent to the receptionist. If you're in the Maryland area, even though the calls are forwarded to our Virginia office, but you may call 301-949-1500 and you will have someone available. We do also have an office in Maryland. If you live in Maryland, you cannot come all the way down to Virginia. We can also meet you in our Maryland office.
Thank you so much for granting me this interview. and we'll make sure that we reach the community.
Thank you so much.
The community can always come for advice.
I appreciate you. I always do.
Thank you so much. You're welcome.
Thank you.
Good.
My boo from the west side, no need to test side. She come through anytime, side. She like me cause I make sure to come, side. Every day, all day, we the rock this world like Bobby Wee. She understand the meaning of loyalty. She keep it 100 all day, I bet you know that. That's what a soldier needs, so I try to provide a need. Then when I run down, she the run things, because of that step under the fiesta.
Travel, you need it, yo, who go stay? Girl who never play. I'm looking for a girl who go pray. Not a foggy cake, girl who's here to stay. As independent as you are, you'll be my star, feminine like a star. Yoni, I just a joker, kebobaya.